Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak and for organizing the conference in these difficult conditions. Too bad many of us didn't get to get Boy Best tonight, but hopefully in the future all of us will get an opportunity to do that. So I'm going to talk about rotated odometers. This is a project joint with Henk Bruin, on which we have been working in, for the past year, and the paper went on the archive about a week ago. What are rotated odometers? This is a specific class of infinite interval exchange transformation. And why rotated odometers are interesting? Well, I can name a couple of reasons. First, rotated odometers model first return maps of flows, of rational slope on translation surfaces with interesting topology and geometry. Second, we can consider rotated odometers as perturbation of the von Neumann-Kalkutani map. And this is basically the standard dyadic odometer, which has appeared already a few times in this conference in CHOCS. The methods we are going to use are substitutions and Bradley diagrams. And again, we have seen Bradley diagrams and substitutions many times. So I thank the previous speakers for setting this, the scene for me. And we're interested in basically classification problems of rotated odometers. And in particular, we will be studying factors, measure theoretical and continuous factors of the systems using spectral properties. So here on the slide, I have the formula for the von Neumann-Kalkutani map. This is an infinite interval exchange transformation. We have a unit interval, and it is subdivided into smaller subintervals of different lengths. The length of each next subinterval, which I denoted by I1, I2, and so on in my picture, the length of each next subinterval is 2 times less than the length of the previous one. And the picture shows how the von Neumann-Kalkutani maps this, rearranges this interval within the unit interval. What does this map have to do with the standard dyadic odometer? So here I have a typo on the slide. 0, 1 should be to the power of n and not of z. So these are one-sided sequences. This is the probably most well-known representation of the dyadic odometer when we look at all infinite sequences of zeros and ones. And the map on the sequences is addition of one with an infinite carry to the right. So the nice property of this map on a Cantor set that it is continuous, while the Kalkutani von Neumann map is it has discontinuities, countable number of discontinuities. So what we can do is we can construct an embedding of a unit interval into the Cantor set by using the standard technique, adding limit points. So whenever we have a discontinuity, we will add an additional limit point. So these are all standard methods, so I'm not going to go into details about that. But the result is that we get an embedding of the Kalkutani von Neumann map into the dyadic odometer, and this gives us measurable isomorphism, measure theoretical isomorphism between the von Neumann-Kalkutani map and the standard dyadic odometer. Now, what is a rotated odometer? We are going to precompose the von Neumann-Kalkutani map with a finite interval exchange transformation. We will fix a Q. We will subdivide the unit interval into Q subintervals of equal length, and we will look at a map which is induced by a permutation of Q symbols. So pi is a permutation, and R of pi, this is the induced map on the interval. So of course, this changes the dynamics. And here in the picture, I have two graphs. On the left, this is the graph of the von Neumann-Kakutani map. And in the picture on the right, we pre-composed the von Neumann-Kakutani map with a translation by one-third. And in terms of permutations, translation by one-third would be permutation 0, 1, 2. So intervals are numbered from 0 to q minus 1. So this is what I mean by a rotated odometer. Although we look at all possible permutations on Q symbols, some of them correspond to rotations, some do not correspond to rotations, they're more complicated, but we will still call any map obtained by this method a rotated odometer. And what we want to study is the dynamics of the system and ergodic properties of them. But before I will go into methods and details, I'd like to just say a few more words about motivation for studying these systems.
So there is a question of Ville on the chat.
So if Q is equal to 2, then... yeah, I guess so. And if Q is equal to powers of 2, then all systems get are equicontinuous, but the dynamics is a bit more complicated. But we are mostly interested here in Q greater or equal to 3, actually, because it's just more interesting. Okay, so a few words about motivation. So I said that the rotated odometers model first Chern maps on of flows of rational slope on certain translation surfaces, namely this. What I mean by model is that there is a measure theoretical isomorphism between these systems. So, given a rotated odometer, I can always find a surface which is has interesting topological properties, namely it's a Loch Ness monster, such that the Church-Chern map of the flow of rational slope is measure theoretically isomorphic to my rotated odometer system. I'm not going to talk about that in detail now, but maybe at the end of the talk, if I have enough time, but just to give you some idea, here I have some have pictures of surfaces which appear in the theorem on the previous slide. So the surface on the left is called the Loch Ness monster. You should think about it as the Lake Loch Ness, and there is a Loch Ness monster emerging. So this is a surface of infinite genus. There is an infinite number of handles attached. And the surface on the left is a modification of that, except we add some viscous, like a cat has viscous. And this has to do with the number of ends on the surface. Okay, so the next few slides are going to be a bit technical because I'm going to give you some idea about the methods we use. So what we're going to do is use coding, a sequence of coding partitions of our, for our system. So we have a fixed Q and we have a permutation. We are going to find an interval, which is a subinterval of the unit interval, which which is small enough that it fits into one set of length Q. And its length is a reverse multiple of 2, but it's big enough. So here is the picture which illustrates what we are going to do. We are going to take an interval. So here in the picture, this is an interval, unit interval, which is subdivided into three sets. So these three sets will constitute a coding partition for me. What does this mean? I take also a section, which is denoted by L1 there. And here, this section has length 1/4. Now I can also subdivide, I can look at the second partition of my interval, which subdivides the interval into 1/4 to the power, 1/4, basically into 12 sets. So, and this induces the subdivision of the interval L1 into three sets. So into Q sets in the general case. We can look at the first return map on this interval, L1. And what we are going to do is the following. So we take one small blue interval from L1, and we apply the rotated odometer. Not the first return map yet, but the rotated odometer. When we do that, the orbit of the interval travels. Of the small intervals travels within the interval from 0 to 1. And what we are going to do is record the number of the set which it hits at each time. So we start in the set. So I have three sets here. They're numbered by 0, 1, and 2. So I start with a blue, small blue interval, which is contained in the 0 set. So I write 0. And then I apply the rotated odometer. Maybe I end up in the last set. Then I write 2, and so on and so on. And we do that until we return back to the first interval. We return back to the interval L1. And we are going to repeat that infinite number of times. So we are going to look at the nested collection of sections. And for each of them, we are looking at the first return map. And we code, we subdivide each section into Q intervals, and we use the partition of the previous section to code the orbit, a finite piece of the orbit. So this is the method of coding partitions, and basically this is also a reasonably standard method in dynamics. Okay, so what can we say about the dynamics of rotated odometers using this method? So first of all, we find out that rotated odometers need not be minimal systems. They may have periodic points, and these periodic points are not isolated. If you have a periodic point, you actually have a half-open interval of periodic points. The set of periodic points for a rotated odometer may be empty, or it may be a finite union of half-open intervals, or it may even be an infinite union of half-open intervals. But in any case, there is also an aperiodic subsystem. In particular, the orbit of zero is never periodic. And actually, our von Neumann-Kakutani map is not invertible at zero, so zero cannot be periodic. There is always, so what I wanted to say is that there is always an aperiodic subsystem. We can also figure out that every first return map on our section has a nice structure. It can also be written down as a composition of a permutation of Q intervals, of a map induced by a permutation of two intervals, and a scaled copy of von Neumann-Kakutani map. And when we look at the non-periodic subsystem, it turns out that it always has unique minimal subset. So these are the properties of the rotated odometers we can deduce. But of course, our rotated odometer still has discontinuities, and it is easier usually to work with continuous maps. So we're going to use a method similar to the one I described for the dyadic odometer. We are going to embed our aperiodic system, non-periodic subsystem of the odometer, into a Cantor set. And the technique is basically the same. You take all the same as for the dyadic odometer, except now you restrict only for the to the non-periodic subsystem, not to the whole interval. But still, it turns out that if you take all discontinuity points and their forward and backward orbits, then the set of these orbits is going to be dense in the in the set of points with non-periodic orbits. So using the same technique as before, we will just for each of these points, we will just add a limit point to our non-periodic subsystem. There is a standard way to put a topology on this space. This is called order topology. And also by standard arguments, we can show that the resulting space is a Cantor set. We can use limits to extend the map, the rotated odometer map, to this modified space. And it turns out that the extension is continuous, which is a homeomorphism. So similar to the dyadic odometer, we constructed an embedding of our non-periodic subsystem of the rotated odometer into a Cantor set. And so we switched to the study of the dynamics of a homeomorphism on a Cantor set. And the orbit, which the one-sided orbit of zero, which you had before it was one-sided, once we do this construction, it actually gets joined with the backward orbit of one of the points we add. So this orbit is also two-sided now. Okay, now let us return back to coding for a little bit. So as I said, we have a sequence of sections. We look at the first return maps to the sections, and we use the partitions of the sections to code orbits. So for each section, this way we get a substitution with the alphabet with Q symbols. But the substitutions may depend on the section. So when I start with some rotated odometer and I restrict to the subsection, the system which I get there, may, the permutation which describes the first return map need not be the same permutation with which I started. But the good news is that although the substitution may be different for different sections, the sequence of substitutions is always eventually periodic. So it becomes periodic after a certain step. And this is good because this means that we will be able to use the method developed by just constant constant sequences of substitutions and stationary Bradley diagrams to study our system. Okay, so Many speakers before me described Bradley diagrams, so I'm not going to go into details about how they work. I will just show you how we build Bradley diagram in this particular case for rotated odometers. So remember, we have a sequence of substitutions. Our Bradley diagram is going to be rooted. So on the zeroth level, we have only one vertex, V0. On each next level, we are going to have Q vertices, where Q is the number of sets in the coding partitions. Next, we need to define the sets of edges between vertices. We use the standard way to do that using substitutions. So when we are at level K, and we choose a vertex I on the level K plus one, what we do is we look at the substitution word chi K of I, and for each vertex J on the Kth level, we count the number of occurrences of J in the substitution word. This will give us the number of edges between J and I. Now, in order to have dynamics on the Bradley diagram, we need to define total order on the set of infinite incoming edges to each vertex. So we just number these edges in the same order in which symbols J appear in the substitution nodes. And then in the standard way, which was already described by many speakers before, these total orders on sets of incoming vertices define a reverse lexicographic order on the space of infinite paths in the Bradley diagram. Now, a good feature of our system is that it actually has a unique minimal and unique maximal path with respect to this order. So the unique minimal path is easy to see. Remember, I told you that when we start coding, our first letter is always going to be zero because because the section is contained in the interval, in the very first interval of the partition. So the minimal path is just corresponds to that. And unique maximal path is a little bit more complicated to explain, but one can see quite easily that there is indeed a unique maximal path. And so the benefit of that is that our system, our Bradley diagram, admits a Wershak map. But so far I described the coding of the orbits in the unit interval, and I said before that we may have subintervals of periodic orbits. So when we build the Bradley diagram, as I described on the previous slide, this may not yet be the diagram we want to be working with. Because we want our diagram to describe the dynamics of the aperiodic system. So in order to move to the aperiodic system, we may need to take a sub-diagram of the diagram we just constructed. And basically, when we take the sub-diagram, well, we will just there is a standard way to do that. For this sub-diagram, we will have a set of infinite paths. The unique maximal and minimal paths will be contained in this set, and there will be an induced Wershak map on this sub-diagram. And similarly, we can find also subdiagram corresponding to the minimal subsystem of our aperiodic system. So now we have two Bradley diagrams, one corresponding to the non-periodic system and one corresponding to its minimal subsystem. And we will be working with these two diagrams. Okay, so I described our methods, and now I will be discussing the results. So first, some results about ergodic measures. The first natural question is the following. Is the Lebesgue measure on the unit interval ergodic for our rotated odometer? And our result is that Lebesgue measure is ergodic if and only if there are no periodic points. One direction is easy because, as you may remember, I said that periodic points come in half-open subintervals. And for the other direction, one needs to work a little bit. But this is the result. Lebesgue measure is ergodic if and only if there are no periodic points. Now, let us look at the non-periodic system and, in particular, the minimal subsystem, which are described by Bradley diagrams. And I forgot to mention that since the sequence of substitutions which we obtained using codings is eventually periodic, this means that by telescoping, we can actually modify our Bradley diagram to stationary Bradley diagram. And so we can use all the standard methods for stationary diagrams to study the dynamics of our system. Okay, so we know that the minimal subsystem is always uniquely ergodic. We have some examples to illustrate that. For example, if I take Q equal to 3, I can look at the permutations corresponding to the rotation by 1/3 and rotation by 2/3. So these are permutations 0, 1, 2, and 0, 2, 1. In both cases, it shows out that the rotated odometer has no periodic points. And moreover, in these two cases, the aperiodic subsystem is actually minimal. So we conclude that for Q equal to 3, for these two systems, the rotated odometer is uniquely ergodic, and the measure corresponds to the Lebesgue measure on the unit interval. But not all rotated odometers are going to be so nice. And in particular, very rarely we encounter aperiodic subsystems which are minimal. Very often they're actually not minimal. We can still study ergodic measures on these systems. And for that, we are going to use the results of the paper by Bezugli, Kvetkovsky, Medinets, and Salamyak in ergodic theory and dynamical systems. And Alena Karpel also discussed these results yesterday in detail. So basically, what we need. So when we have a stationary Bradley diagram, we can look at the substitution matrix of this diagram. By telescoping and maybe renaming the symbols in our coding partitions, we can always put this matrix into the normal Frobenius form. And Alena had examples for that, and I will have some examples in a second. So then for this Frobenius normal form, you look for eigenvalues and the left eigenvectors. The number of eigenvalues which are greater than 1 and which have non-negative left eigenvectors would correspond to the number of invariant measures. And in particular, since the substitution matrix are always Q by Q, by our constructions, this tells us that we can have at most Q invariant ergodic measures for our rotated odometers, Although I must say that in examples so far, we have encountered only situations when there is one invariant ergodic measure or two. It is not clear what the pattern is, and maybe the reason is that we only looked at the small values of Q. I think not higher than 11 or maybe 13. So we can have at most Q invariant ergodic measures, but often we encounter less. So here are some examples. So let us check Q equal to 5, and the finite interval exchange transformation is going to be a rotation by 1 over 5. So this is just the permutation 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. It turns out, after we drew the computations, it turns out that the sequence of substitutions we obtain by studying first sections and first return maps, this sequence is actually constant. At each step, you get the same substitution. Also, we can determine that there are no periodic points. So the Lebesgue measure is ergodic. Here in the slide, I have the Frobenius normal form of the substitution matrix for this system. We need to rename some symbols in order to obtain this matrix. So this matrix has three blocks. The first block, 1, 1, 1, 1, corresponds to the minimal subsystem and to the ergodic measure supported on the minimal subset. And the last non-zero block, 8, corresponds to another ergodic measure which is supported on the whole counter set and which corresponds to the Lebesgue measure on the unit interval.
Sorry, your question on the substitution, the Poitier diagram has always constant path number property?
Could you repeat the question? Sorry, I didn't hear
Bratelli Verschick diagram has a path equal path number property.
Equal path number property.
Equal.
So by that, do you mean that the number of edges, the number of paths ending at each vertex is equal? Is
yes.
That what you mean?
Yes.
No, they don't have to have this property. They're not simple in general, and they do. They have equal path number property in the two examples I discussed earlier for Q equal to 3. So, but in general, no.
Okay. All right, a question of Nathalie. What expansion factor does this example have?
What is an expansion factor? What do you mean by expansion factor?
Ooh, there are several questions in the chat.
Okay. I'm not sure about the expansion factor.
Nathalie, you want to precise that there were substitutions.
The substitutions can have very kind of ugly form. For example, one word can be very short and maybe one very, very long word. Okay, maybe we can discuss that later.
Okay, maybe you have also a question of Marie-Isabelle. The existence of periodic points and the dynamical property in general does depend on Q, P, and N. And she asks if it has sense to try to say something about N, P, and Q such that they are not periodic points, for instance.
So this is a very good question. And the answer is so far we haven't been able to find any pattern. So far, the results which we get, specifically other periodic points, if the non-periodic subsystem minimal or not, this is basically a case-by-case study. So, and actually, this is an open question. Are there any conditions which you can state which would force, say, the system to have periodic points? But at the moment, it's not clear. Okay.
Felipe Felipe asked if the rotated odometers can be of finite rank in the measurable Kakutani-Rokin sense.
So, for every rotated odometer, the Bratteli diagram has finite rank. There is a constant number of vertices at each level. Does that answer your question? Okay. Okay, let us move to the measure theoretical and continuous factors for the minimal subsystem. So to determine rotational factors, we are going to study the spectrum of the Koopman operator for the minimal subsystem. So I will just recall a few well-known facts. We know that the eigenvalues of the Koopman operator are on the unit circle. And in this particular setting, when we're working with substitution, if a number is an eigenvalue, then the corresponding eigenfunction is automatically continuous. This is the result by Host. And therefore, the measurable and continuous factors of our system kind set. Okay, so here is our theorem. Suppose we look at the minimal subsystem of the aperiodic system. So remember I said that we can look at our rotated odometer as a permutation of of the dyadic odometer. So therefore, we can ask a natural question. How much of the structure of the dyadic odometer is preserved when we apply this perturbation? So, and in particular, maybe a more precise formulation of that, we know that often when we look at the rotated odometers, this perturbation destroys the minimality of the system, but there is still a unique non-periodic subsystem with a unique minimal set. Does it have a dyadic odometer as a factor? And in which situations the aperiodic system itself has a dyadic odometer as a factor? And the answer is given in this theorem. There exists infinitely many systems, infinitely many rotated odometers, which have the dyadic odometer as a factor for their minimal subsystem. But it doesn't have to be always the case, because we are able to find examples and construct infinitely, building on those examples, construct infinitely many systems, infinitely many rotated odometers, where the minimal subsystem does not have the dyadic odometer as a factor, but it also not weakly mixing. It has other eigenvalues. At the moment, we cannot say which are more prevalent. The only thing we can say which are more prevalent, rotated odometers which have the dyadic odometer as a factor, or those which are not. What we can say is that for smaller numbers of Q, it is much easier to find a system where the dyadic odometer is a factor. And In order to find a system where the dyadic odometer is not a factor, maybe you need to look for a little while. But it's not clear at the moment whether any of the situation is generic, for example. And in generic in what sense? That's also a question.
A question of Rodrigo.
There is a question in the chat from Rodrigo.
Yes.
Could you answer it, please?
Oh. So Qs which appear in this theorem, yes, they may have factors of two, but they do not have, they cannot be a power of two. So they should have at least one factor which is not two. Okay, so let us study the factors. Let me see that I need the slide. So this is the example which we have already seen. Q is 5, and the permutation corresponds to the rotation of translation by 1 over 5. There is a minimal sub-diagram of the Bratteri diagram which we construct. It just has vertices 0 and 3 in the sub-diagram. And this is the matrix, the substitution matrix. So we look at the sub-matrix corresponding to the minimal sub-diagram. And basically, we use the methods we use to compute eigenvalues has to do with heights of stacks in the Bratteri diagram. So in particular, the heights can be written down using recurrence relation, which involve eigenvalues of the substitution matrix. So in particular, if all eigenvalues of the matrix are divisible by two, we can say that every 1 over 2 to the power m will give us will produce for us an eigenvalue of the Koopman operator. So here, the matrix has eigenvalues 0 and 2, and therefore, we conclude that for every m 1 over 2, every dyadic rational gives us an eigenvalue, and therefore, the dyadic odometer is a factor of the minimal subsystem. And in fact, the minimal subsystem is conjugate to the dyadic odometer because we can easily see there are no other eigenvalues, and therefore, by I think it's called by Neumann theorem, they're going to be measurably isomorphic. Okay. So now, what about the systems which do not have the dyadic odometer as a factor? So, to answer the question of Maria Isabel, I'm now going to. This is an example where we actually have irrational eigenvalues. So again, Q is 5, and now the permutation 5. Permutation is 0, 2, 4, 3, 1. So this is not a rotation. Again, by studying the system, we can find out that there are no periodic points and the Lebesgue measure is ergodic. I have written down the substitution matrices for the full diagram and also for the minimal subsystem. So for the minimal subsystem, this is a 4x4 matrix. We can compute the eigenvalues of this matrix, and they turn out to be 2 plus or minus square root of 5. And there is also a negative 1 of multiplicity 2, but negative 1 doesn't matter because the initial vector of heights for the first level of Bratteri diagrams, it decomposes over the eigenvectors for right eigenvectors for the values 2 plus or minus square root of 5. So here our matrix, our substitution matrix for minimal subsystem has irrational eigenvalues. So will that give an irrational eigenvalue for the Koopman operator? The answer is on the next slide. We can use the results of Firenze, Modit, and Nogueira to show that indeed there are irrational eigenvalues. Now, the question is, okay, we have some irrational eigenvalues. Are there rational eigenvalues in addition? And first of all, we're interested in the question, do we have a dyadic odometer as a factor? So we need to look at the dyadic rationals. So it is easy to see that dyadic rationals are not going to give us any eigenvalues, because by looking at the matrix here, you can see that the vector of height of the Bradley diagram for each level, its components going to be odd numbers, so they're never divisible by two. And this tells us that the dyadic odometer is not going to be a factor. Sorry. And in fact, by a different computation, we can show that, that there are actually no rational eigenvalues at all. So in this example, the minimal subsystem has irrational eigenvalues. The dyadic odometer is not a factor, but the system is also not weakly mixing. Okay. So now, what can we say about factors for the full aperiodic subsystem? Again, we can study the spectrum of the Koopman operator to answer this question. Again, we use the results from the paper of Bizugu, Kvitkovsky, Mendonets, and Salamek, which gives us conditions which allow to determine eigenvalues of the Koopman operator. They're somewhat similar to the minimal case, but a bit more complicated. And in particular, if you manage to find an eigenvalue, which is a measurable eigenvalue, the eigenfunction will not automatically be continuous. And also, since now we may have multiple ergodic measures, we may have complications because of different eigenvalues. What do we find? So here we do not have an infinite number of examples, but we have just two examples. But still, we can determine that, again, answering the same question, does the rotated odometer have to have the dyadic odometer as a factor, measurable or continuous? So we can find examples of rotated odometers which do have the dyadic odometer as a maximal equicontinuous factor. And at the same time, we can find rotated odometers which do not have the dyadic odometer as a factor. And in fact, we have two ergodic measures, and they have different, the Koopman operator has different eigenvalues. So let us look at this example in detail. Okay, so we're returning again back to the example of Q5, and the permutation is a rotation by 1 over 5. We have seen this matrix already before. Now we look at the eigenvalues of the whole matrix, and the eigenvalues are 8, 2, and 0 has multiplicity 3, but 0 doesn't match at all. And since 8 is also divisible by 2, it follows that the measure mu 2 also has the same eigenvalues as the minimal subsystem. And as a consequence, the dyadic odometer is a factor of our rotated odometer. And actually, by using an additional argument, we can show that the dyadic odometer is the maximal equicontinuous factor for this system. So this system is very nicely behaved. Now, again, this is the Q5, and this is the same permutation which we saw before, which had where the minimal system had irrational eigenvalues. Again, we want to to figure out what are the factors, and now we are looking at the ergodic measure mu chu. So the matrix of the system has eigenvalues 8, 2 plus or minus square root of 5, and negative 1 of multiplicity 2, but for the same reason I described before, negative 1 doesn't match. And remember that we figured out that the minimal subsystem has some irrational eigenvalues. So the question is, does the full rotated odometer have irrational eigenvalues? The answer is no, it doesn't have irrational eigenvalues. It does have some eigenvalues, and these are the eigenvalues corresponding to M1 and 2 in this formula. So, and we can all, by technical computation, we can also figure out that apart from these two eigenvalues, there are no other rational or irrational eigenvalues. So we can conclude that the rotated odometer factors onto the finite group with four elements. But this factor map is not going to be continuous using the criterion in the paper I mentioned. Okay, so this is all about the factors. To finish, I wanted to pose a couple of open questions. So, as I already mentioned, answering questions, what do we know about rotated odometers right now? We know that the dynamics is complicated, and it also doesn't have to be very closely related to the dyadic odometer in the sense that a rotated odometer doesn't have to have a dyadic odometer as a factor. But again, we cannot find any conditions on Q or the permutation which would ensure that by just looking at that, we can conclude that the dyadic odometer is a factor or is not a factor. So I pose that as an open question. We would like to find necessary and sufficient condition under which the aperiodic subsystem of the rotated odometer or its minimal subsystem has a dyadic odometer as a factor. And as a related question, are there actually any rotated odometers which can be, which admit, for which the Lebesgue or the measure on the minimal subset can be weakly mixing? We were not able to find such examples yet. Okay. So I don't think I have enough time to explain about Loch Ness monsters. So let me just move to an open question about Loch Ness monsters. So anyway, maybe I will just quickly describe the result. So another theorem in our paper is the following. Suppose we are given a permutation, and we are given and so we are given a rotated odometer. Then we can find a translation surface, and we can find a flow on this translation surface, so that its first return map is conjugate to the rotated odometer. So the surface which appears in this system, so whenever you have a rotation, you can realize this rotated odometer on the same surface. But if you have if you're looking for a more complicated permutation, you may need to modify the topology of the surface a little bit by adding additional singularities, and that's what produces this surface, which we call Loch Ness monster with viscous. So here in this picture, for example, we would have to add two additional simple singularities, conangle singularities to the surface. And this is the flows which we model, they all have rational flow. So therefore, an open problem is the following. Is it possible to use a similar approach to describe flows of irrational flow on a translation surface? This seems to be a complicated question. Okay, so here is some references I mentioned in my talk, and thank you for listening.
So thank you very much. Thank you, Olga, for your talk. Is there any question?
Okay, so okay, question. I assume that there is nothing special about the dyadic odometer, and it's the same sum of results for rotated p-adic odometers. Yes, possibly. But I can't say for sure. I'd like to be careful making statements about higher p's.
Okay. Any other questions?
A question in Marseille is: can you say what about the typical dynamic of your of the system with respect to the permutation p? I mean, do you have some can you say what's happened for the dynamic precisely for a positive density of permutation? There is something typical that occurs, function of the of the permutation or not?
So it is not clear at the moment what is typical. That's the problem. And also it's so there are examples with properties that the dynamics is more similar to the dyadic odometer in the sense that the dyadic odometer is a factor. There are examples for which the dyadic odometer is not a factor, but it's not clear what would be the on what this conclusion would depend. It may be possible that when your permutation corresponds to just a rotation, so that just a translation, say like 1/5, 1/q, p over q, maybe the dynamics is better behaved, because the example which does not have the dyadic odometer as a factor, this is for the permutation which is not a rotation. But it's possibly not enough evidence to make make it a conjecture or something like that. Not enough evidence. It's basically just one example. And maybe the problem is that it's a bit difficult to make very general statements, say for very large q, for say q 2007. It's very difficult to make concrete statements about the dynamics, because what you actually need to do is compute, build a Bradley diagram, and analyze it. But it's not clear yet at the moment whether we can produce any very general statements without actually knowing too many details about the dynamics.
So there is a few questions on the chat, especially the first one that I see is that, do you know anything about the continuous component of a spectrum? Or is there always a continuous component?
You mean, are there always continuous eigenfunctions? So I don't know. In some cases, there are. So for the minimal subsystem, as I said, we haven't found any weakly mixing examples. And for the full odometer, there is an example where there is no continuous factor. Okay, so question: is there any easy way to see how to go from the permutation to the substitution? not really actually have to compute. And as I said, some substitutions are pretty ugly in the sense that the substitution words, they have very different lengths. Very often you have one very, very long word and the other ones are very short, like two or three symbols.
So there is also a question of Boris Solomiak asking if you have examples so you can verify pure discrete spectrum. And
so Henk already has answered that.
Yes. Chat. There is also a question of Felipe.
Is there a type of Rossi induction to get the substitution easily? Yeah, I don't know.
Okay, so I think that we will just wait for the last two comments from which are people are typing now, and after this we will close the session. So Danos is asking, it sounds like the substitution are pretty similar to beta substitution. Do you have any comment on this?
Okay, for the question by Philippa, I think you're referring to the book I mentioned in slides, Delacroix, Hubert and Valdes. So the first three chapters are available online on the webpage of Vincent Delacroix. So you can go, you can find it there.
Okay, so thank you very much for this very interesting talk, and it finishes the session this afternoon. And for the people in Marseille, we'll have a nice meal. And for all the other people in the audience, have a nice end of your day. So bye-bye.
Goodbye. It's a bouillabaisse session. So thank you again.
Yes. Enjoy your birthday.